I welcome all the devotees and also those who have come to visit the temple. Please welcome. So today we'll be doing the remaining part of the 11th chapter of the Bhagavad Gita. I'm sorry we had to miss one class. We'll make up as we go along. So we'll just have very short Jai Radha Madhava prayers and then we can start. Jaya Radha Madhava Kunja Bihari Jaya Radha Madhava Kunja Bihari Kopi jana vallabha girivaradhari Jaya Gopi jana vallabha girivaradhari Jasoda Nandana Vrajajana Ranjana Jasoda Nandana Vrajajana Ranjana Yamuna Tera Vanachari Jaya Radha Madhava Kunja Bihari Gopi Jana Vallabha Girivaradhari Jasoda Nandana Vrajajana Ranjana Yamuna Tira Vanachari Hare Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare 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 Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Jaya Prabhupada, Jaya Prabhupada, Prabhupada Jaya Prabhupada Jaya Guru Deva Jaya Guru Deva Guru Deva Jaya Guru Deva Harinam Sankirtan ki jai Srimad Bhagavad Gita ki jai Hare Krishna I welcome all the devotees, Shivankar Prabhu, Satya Prabhu, Hare Krishna, Saubhagya Mataji, Vishnu in the back, Shraddha, who just walked in, thank you, Hare Krishna. So, I believe we stopped at 22nd verse, but fear not, let's not worry about which verse, thank you. Thank you. We'll just quickly go through all the verses, just to get a quick recap. let's start from verse number 1. We just read the translation. Oh, 37? We stopped here? Yeah, that's what, 23, that's what I was thinking. Somewhere we stopped in the 20s. I'll quickly read the translation, if that's okay. It'll take a few minutes, so that we can at least catch up. Arjuna said, by hearing the instructions you have kindly given me about these most confidential spiritual subjects, my illusion has now been dispelled. O Lotus-Eyed One, I have heard from you in detail about the appearance and disappearance of every living entity and have realized your inexhaustible glories. O greatest of all personalities, O supreme form, though I see you here before me in your actual position, as you have described yourself, I wish to see how you have entered into this cosmic manifestation. I want to see that form of yours. If you think I am able to behold your cosmic form, O my Lord, O Master of all mystic power, then kindly show me that unlimited universal self. The Supreme Personality of Godhead said, My dear Arjuna, O son of Pritha, see now my opulences, hundreds of thousands of varied, divine and multicolored forms. O best of the Bharatas, see here the different manifestations of Adityas, Vasus, Rudras, Ashwini Kumaras, and all other demigods. Behold the many wonderful things which no one has ever seen or heard of before. O Arjuna, whatever you wish to see, behold at once in this body of mine. This universal form can show you whatever you now desire to see and whatever you may want to see in the future. Everything, moving and non-moving, is here completely in one place. But you cannot see me with your present eyes. Therefore, I give you divine eyes. Behold my mystic opulence. Sanjaya said, O King, having spoken thus, the Supreme Lord of all mystic power, the Personality of Godhead, displayed his universal form to Arjuna. Arjuna saw in that universal form unlimited mouths, unlimited eyes, unlimited wonderful visions. The form was decorated with many celestial ornaments and bore many divine appraised weapons. He wore celestial garments and many divine scents were smeared all over his body. All was wondrous, brilliant, unlimited, all expanding. If hundreds of thousands of suns were to rise at once into the sky, their radiance might resemble the effulgence of the Supreme Person in the universal form. At that time, Arjuna could see in the universal form of the Lord the unlimited expansions of the universe situated in one place, although divided into many, many thousands. Then, bewildered and astonished, his hair standing on end, Arjuna bowed his head to offer obeisances and with folded hands began to pray to the Supreme Lord. Arjuna said, My dear Lord Krishna, I see assembled in your body all the demigods and various other living entities. I see Brahma sitting on the lotus flower, as well as Lord Shiva and all the sages and divine serpents. O Lord of the universe, O universal form, I see in your body many, many arms, bellies, mouths and eyes, expanded everywhere without limit. I see in you no end, no middle, and no beginning. Your form is difficult to see because of its glaring effulgence, spreading on all sides, like blazing fire or the immeasurable radiance of the sun. Yet I see this glowing form everywhere, adorned with various crowns, clubs, and discs. You are the supreme primeval object. You are the ultimate resting place of all this universe. You are inexhaustible, and you are the oldest. You are the maintainer of the eternal religion, the personality of Godhead. This is my opinion. You are without origin, middle, or end. Your glory is unlimited. You have numberless arms, and the sun and moon are your eyes. I see you with blazing fire coming forth from your mouth, burning this entire universe by your own radiance. Although you are one, you spread throughout the sky and the planets and all space in between. O Great One, seeing this wondrous and terrible form, all the planetary systems are perturbed. All the hosts of the demigods are surrendering before you and entering into you. Some of them, very much afraid, are offering prayers with folded hands. Hosts of great sages and perfected beings, crying, "All peace," are praying to you by singing the Vedic hymns. All the various manifestations of Lord Shiva, the Adityas, the Vasus, the Sadhyas, the Vishvedevas, and the two Ashvis, the Maruts, the forefathers, the Gandharvas, the Yakshas, the Asuras, and the perfected demigods are beholding you in wonder. So we'll do the from the 23rd. Kindly repeat after me. Rupam mahatte bahuvaktra netram Mahabaho bahu bahu rupadam Bahudaram bahudam strakaralam Drishtva loka pravyatati stataham So, Shraddha, you can start and you can, and then we can go. It's working, just knock, tap. You have to put it to your mouth.
O mighty armed one, all the planets with their demigods are disturbed at seeing your great form, with its many faces, eyes, arms, thighs, legs, and bellies, and your many terrible teeth, and as they are disturbed, so am I.
Thank you. Text 24. Navasprisham deeptamane kavarnam Yatamanam deepta vishala netram Drishtva hitvam pravyatitantaratma Dritim navindami shamam cha vishnu
O all-pervading Vishnu, seeing you with your many radiant colors touching the sky, your gaping mouths and your great glowing eyes, my mind is perturbed by fear. I can no longer maintain my steadiness or equilibrium of mind.
Thank you. Text 25. Dhamstrakaralam chate mukhani. Drishtvaiva kala nala sannibhani. Disho na jane na labhe cha sharma. Prasida devesha jagannivasa.
O Lord of the Lords, O refuge of the worlds, please be gracious to me. I cannot keep my balance seeing thus your blazing death-like faces and awful teeth. In all directions I am bewildered.
Thank you. Ami chatvam dhrartarashtrasya putra. Ami chatvam dhritarashtrasya putra. Sarve sahaiva vanipala sanghai. Bhishmo drona suta putrastatasau. Sahasa madiyairapi yoda mukhyai. Vaktrani te twaramana vishanti. Vaktrani te twaramana vishanti. Sorry. Vaktrani che twaramana vishanti. Damstra karalani bhayanakani. Kechad vilagna dasanantareshu. Sandrishyante churnitairuttamangaihi.
Okay, let's do the last one. We didn't get it.
Sandrishyante churnitair uttamangaihi. Yeah, these verses in 11th chapter, little tongue twisters, but rest assured, all the others are not this. But yeah, go ahead, please do the translation.
All the sons of Dhritarashtra, along with their allied kings, and Bhishma, Drona, Karna, and our chief soldiers also are rushing into your fearful mouths, and some I see trapped with head smashed between your teeth.
Now, in the horror movies, you see people are being slaughtered and killed, and you know all sorts of stuff happening. But here you can see millions of people just being devoured by the head, by the mouth of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. In fact, somebody's head is really smashed in between the teeth. You know, you can just imagine the, a very crude example is like, you know, the Jurassic Park example, where the, you know, the huge teeth are there and then just the neck is just coming out of the teeth. It's gruesome, but the point is, You might philosophically wonder, why is God showing this form of His? You know, He is supposed to be all good, and He is supposed to be all merciful. But Krishna has both the aspects. Please understand, if God is all good, where is evil coming from? If evil is not coming from God, then evil has a power over God. Logically. But God is the source of good and evil. And Krishna is neither affected by good nor affected by evil. So this is an important point. Another thing in this purport is Srila Prabhupada writes is that Krishna promised Arjuna, "O Arjuna, I'll show you something very interesting." And this is what he shows. He says that his own relatives have been subjected to death. And Arjuna was thinking in the beginning, if I kill them, then I will be going to hell. In the first chapter, Arjuna says to Krishna, O Krishna, that if I kill them, all the family sacrificial performances are stopped and all the women will become polluted, there will be unwanted population, and I heard from the sources that those who cause this will go to hell. And so that is one of the reasons which Arjuna said to Krishna that I don't want to kill. But here Krishna is telling Arjuna, sorry, you are not doing the killing. It's I am doing the killing. And that's what he's trying to tell here. Text 28. Are there? Okay. Questions? Anybody?
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna, Vrindavan Priya Prabhu.
Hare Krishna Prabhu, Dandavat Pranam.
Dandavat Pranam.
I wanted to say Haribol, I am online, but I also have a small question.
Yes.
So, I was just thinking that the universal form of the Lord, it has different descriptions.
Mm.
So this particular one looks like very fearsome and like horror, like you were saying. But we also study in third canto of Srimad Bhagavatam, the universal form is described in a very different way.
Mm.
Like the universal body of the Lord, how he creates the different elements, the senses, the mind, the factors of mind, intelligence, and so on. So my question is this particular description of universal form this way because the setting is that of battlefield and it's not the only way to describe the universal form. Is that right?
That's correct. Yeah, thank you for that astute observation. Because Krishna has entered this material world, and then material world has creation, maintenance and destruction. So the Lord is showing all the three aspects. And here in the battlefield of Kurukshetra, he is showing the destruction aspect of it, or his devouring aspect. And it's mentioned later also. Thank you, Vrindavan Priya Prabhu, for that question. Did you have any other thing, or are you satisfied?
Yeah, I think... So you're saying that it's mainly the destruction aspect that he's displaying to Arjuna.
Correct,
it's,
because
it's relevant in the context of the conversation that's going on between them. Like they're about to die anyway, so like that. Right?
Yes, and the other thing is in the third canto, Vrindavan Priya Prabhu is alluding to the fact in the third canto also the universal form is mentioned, but that form is because of creation. All the demigods are created. The material elements are created. And they don't seem to be working together. Like, then they try different ways. You know, unless Lord is putting consciousness into matter, matter doesn't work. Mm-hmm. It's very, so that creation aspect is there in that universal form.
Okay, that makes sense. Okay,
thank you. Thank you. Other questions? Urmi Mataji, you had any questions? Thank you. Ram Prasad, who has a question?
Hare Krishna Prabhu.
Hare Krishna.
Prabhuji, I have a couple of questions on this universal form. First thing, is it the eternal form? Meaning, is it the... Because Lord is displaying... My personal understanding, it is spiritual. But is it... But also it is changing. So is it a temporary material form or is it a spiritual form? And Prabhupada mentions that devotees are not really interested in the universal form. Devotees like the personal form of the Lord. So how do we understand these two aspects?
So the answer to your first question, yes, it is a temporary form. Srila Prabhupada writes in one of the purports towards the last that we'll go and read. He says it's a temporary form. For example, I'll give an example. In times of war, a huge army is assembled and the army has some form, but that seems to be like really some form. But when there is no war, then that army is disassembled. So, but nevertheless, that the person who assembles the army has the power to assemble and disassemble. So similarly, the universal form of Krishna is material, but it is also, so whether it is material or spiritual, we'll talk about it, but it is temporary because the material nature is temporary. Krishna, the thing is, we think that the matter is acting on its own. This thing has a life of its own. But please understand, in Bhagavatam we read, it's amazing that every particle or atom combines together to make matter. And everybody knows that. You know, the matter is composed of atoms. But the question comes is, who is holding them together? By whose power are they staying together? Is there some power that's holding them together, or is it... Again, scientists might give so much example of gravitational force and electronic pull and this push, that push. But the fact of the matter is, they need to have some intelligence to keep it steady. See, I have this glass here, and this is the nice glass. But, you know, if matter is acting randomly, in 2 minutes later there should be no glass and water should be just dripping out. Because the atoms that constituted the glass, the steel glass, should be dissipating because they are coming together, going apart, coming together, going apart. But it doesn't happen. There seems to be some power that's holding them in the shape that they are holding. But who is holding that? And who is creating that? That is Krishna. And because Krishna entered into the universal form and activating it from within, the matter is able to sustain. So, Krishna and his energies are both transcendental. Right? Krishna is transcendental. So, Krishna's energies by nature are transcendental. Though they could be different from Krishna, but that doesn't mean it doesn't belong to Krishna. So, the example is, no honorable person actually goes to prison. Or wants to go to prison. Now there is that story of written by early American author. So every year, come fall, how do you say, a vagabond kind of person, a person who is like, you know, not very having a steady home and just needs a place kind of situation. So every come fall, he starts, the leaves are dropping. All right, the winter is going to come. I need to secure a home. And the way he would secure a home is to commit some small crime. So the police would come, lock him up in the prison, happy there for 4 months, and then when spring comes, then he'll come out of the prison. So, and then that was his endeavor every fall. So this person goes, and he goes to a nice, beautiful store, jewelry, everything going on. And then he takes the rock. Bang! Hits the jewelry store. And then the alarm goes on and police starts running. Oh, he said, police starts coming in his direction. Oh, great, I'm going to be arrested. I'm going to go to jail. And suddenly a man is rushing, running to catch something, or he's in a hurry. And the police thinks that man is the one who is running away. He is the actual culprit, and he runs after them. And then the second time he goes to a public transport, and then he goes to a woman and tries to, like, you know, tease her or try to get her attention so that she'll call the police, and then, you know, he'll be thrown into prison. So he goes and he starts talking and acting funny with a lady. And that lady turns out to be that in that same business. She said, okay, come, let's go. And he was like, oh my God, what is this? And he runs away. So on and on, you know, he tries 2 or 3 attempts like that. And then it doesn't work out. And he says, you know, what am I doing? Why am I wasting my life like this? I should be taking up an honorable job. I should be going to get some work, have a decent life. This is a useless life, trying to lead this life. And then he goes into the church. He goes to the church and he gets all this contemplative thing. And then the police comes. He recognizes him from the old time. He comes, he says, what are you doing in this church? He said, I'm doing nothing. He said, come with me. Let's go to prison. It's an ironical ending, but that is the story. And please forgive me, I am not here to come here to tell stories, but stories are nice. When we discuss Krishna's energy is material or spiritual, is jail a proper place or an improper place? Is it a desirable or an undesirable place? No, in terms of the season. By and large, it's undesirable. But nevertheless, the jail is maintained by the government.
When a person is killed, it is, you know, the lethal injection is given to a murderer, that is done on the order of the government. So government has both aspects to it, and Krishna has the material and spiritual aspects to it. In that sense, they are both spiritual, but matter is something which is differentiated from Krishna, and that we need not dabble in much too much. Is that answer your question? Okay, that's the first part. And second part, okay, that I think two questions are answered. Any other questions? Shubhankar Prabhu? Thank you. Next verse? Yes. Prabhuji.
Hare Krishna, Prabhu.
Hare Krishna.
The third canto, Vrindavan Priya Prabhu was referring, in that universal form, I think towards the end, all the demigods are trying to wake him up. I don't remember why they are trying to wake him up. Maybe to start the creation, or they are unable to do the creation. I don't know what is that. But towards the end, I think he wakes up when they enter his heart with reason. I think that's when he wakes up, right? And so that is one universal form. But this universal form, Krishna is saying that very clearly, who is he, basically? He is like time. So are they the same universal forms? Like,
they are the same.
They are the same.
It's just the manifestation is different.
Okay.
So there it's the all-pervading Lord, the super soul of everything. And he doesn't manifest this deadly form. But here, on account of Arjuna's request, he manifests that form. Because everything that's happening in the world, all the, you know, the unfair, the gross, the violent, the extremely gut-wrenching violence that takes place. You know, today in morning in the Bhakti Vaibhava, you know, the classes we were discussing about the Holocaust and so on and so forth, why that happens, and some devotee bought up and said, this is like horrible. Everything is happening is a manifestation of that universal form. So good and bad comes. It's hard to see because Krishna is spread throughout the universe. Mm. You can't see him in a personal fashion unless he brings everything together and shows it to you. And that which he is showing to Arjuna now.
Mm, okay.
Other questions? Yes. And then Mataji in the back. Yeah, Satya Prabhu and then Mataji in the back. Yeah.
So when we talk about good and bad, sometimes, I mean, at least this one question that used to trouble me. So it is our perception that it is bad. When someone dies, we think it is actually bad. But maybe for the soul, whatever Krishna is doing is actually good. So is my understanding.
Krishna says, Suhridam sarva bhutanam jnatvam aam shantir icchati, that I am the well-wisher of every living entity. Whatever he does is for our own benefit. Whether we choose to accept him, or whether we don't choose to accept him is our choice. But he is complete. Otherwise, there is no. His words are false. If he is malicious, his intent is malevolent towards someone, means he is not the well-wisher of every living entity. Now, what sort of justice can you get from the ultimate seat of justice? That is Krishna. Krishna is completely impartial. He is completely knowledgeable, and he knows everything, and he can judge everything perfectly. We can't judge, but he can judge perfectly. So, is that okay? Thank you. Yes, Mataji. Your good name?
Babita.
Babita.
Namaste.
Okay.
I'm attending this for the first time, so maybe you'll have covered this earlier, but you mentioned something which I wanted to understand. You said that the good and the evil both is within God, because the evil cannot be more powerful than Krishna. So, I just wanted to understand a little more about that.
So, evil inherently is not in Krishna, but he is the source of that evil nature amongst us. But when in hands of God, that quote-unquote evil is actually good, when it is misused against the purpose of God, that same evil becomes bad. I'll give an example. A surgeon does an operation and he cuts wounds and injures a person, technically speaking, but the intention is to actually cure that person. But whereas a person who is imitating the surgeon without having the knowledge and intention might actually cause more harm. So from Krishna comes everything, good and bad, but when you
use it for your own selfish, egoistic purposes, that actually becomes harmful. I'll give another example. A mother, does he or does she not chastise her child? Otherwise, the child wants to eat potato chips and drink Coke all day long. And mother has to step in to actually correct that child for the benefit of the child. So Krishna's intention is pure completely and he is all good. But since there is the evil in the jivas, he allows that to happen. So in that sense, he is also quote-unquote facilitating that evil. Is that okay? But eventually, this is good or evil is mental concoction in this world. Anything that is done for Krishna is always all good. And anything that is done against will of Krishna, even though technically it is good, is evil. That's the absolute meaning. So, because if Krishna is all good, then why is there evil in the world? Why does he allow that to happen? But Krishna is showing that I am death personified. I am actually devouring all these people. So there is the higher purpose of Krishna which is being perverted by the people of this world to be used for their own selfish, egoistic purposes. And that becomes evil. Is that a little bit helpful? Yeah.
I have a question.
Sanket had. So he raised his hand. Said. So after this, is that okay? Sorry.
Prabhu, you already mentioned why there is a need of evil in this world. I think it's only in the material world, right? Not in the spiritual world.
Spiritual world is all good. There is no question of evil.
So is it because that we realize that this is not a good place or this is not a... why is the need of like such atrocity everywhere?
Because I am the controller and I am the enjoyer of this world. Everything belongs to me. If you don't obey me, and I'm going to kill you. It's just pure evil. Even if I perceive that you are my enemy, even you didn't do anything, you just looked at me funny. It happened. And then I think you are just insulting me by just looking at me in a funny way, or even looking at me. Previously, kings, actually, nobody would look at the king directly in the eye. They would look like this. Yes, Huzur. If you look at him in the eye, hey, you're looking at me, you're distressing me, I'm going to kill you. So where is the question? So because I am the controller and I am taking this insult, I'm going to kill you and I have the power to do so. Nobody is going to kill me if I kill you. So that I know. That's why I'm abusing that power. You have dictators in the modern world, in some countries, in Asia and other places. I don't want to name the countries. But they randomly kill people. Perceived or otherwise, they think this guy is an enemy, kill them. And Bhagavad Gita in 16th chapter, if you hold your thoughts, we'll discuss that at length, how the demoniac nature pervades. So they are demoniac people and therefore the evil pervades in this material world. Krishna says, okay, I facilitate. Okay, Sadhana Mataji, Sid had his hand before you, so thank you. Yeah.
So yes, my Sid. Question was, does Krishna address the subject of evil and good in the Bhagavad Gita?
Yes, by speaking Bhagavad Gita itself. Seriously, because in this world, people come with no clue of where they have come from. Every human being comes, I'm born, I live here for some time, I die. I don't care about afterlife. I really don't care what happens to me. I got one life and I have to enjoy it to the maximum. Good, evil, all that is all bogus. What I want is good. When others object to what I want, they are evil. That is my definition of good and bad in this world. But Krishna comes and says, look, wake up. This one life that you got is amongst the countless billion trillions of lives that you have actually taken. And you'll keep suffering in this material world if you don't awaken to your real consciousness. And that's what Bhagavad Gita is explaining. Time and again he comes. He has no need to come. Please understand, don't take it for a second that God has some need to enjoy this material world. Not even a crazy president of the United States, such as the present one, will go to a prison just to enjoy how is the prison food. Or how is the life in prison? I want to spend one day in prison. I want to see how it is. I want to enjoy it. Everybody knows it's like, It's like the most unenjoyable place. Krishna says this material world is dukkhalayam and asashvatam. Why would he come and say, okay, let me see what is there? He comes purely for the purpose of delivering the conditioned souls who he feels for. You people are just wasting your lives. Let me at least come and reveal my pastimes to you so that you can, you know that and you can be liberated from this cycle of birth and death. So that is Krishna's benefit. Is that okay? Sid? You had more question.
Yeah, my question was more specifically, does he define what is evil?
Yes, he says that anything done in the So he says in the third chapter of Bhagavad Gita, Yajnartha karmanonyatra lokoyam karma. He says that if you work for your own selfish enjoyment, then you are bound in this material world. That is your greatest enemy. It is like if you want to liberate yourself, if your hands are tied, would you ask someone, would you do something to so that you can make those knots stronger or try to get out of them? So he says, look, you are a small, tiny fraction jiva. You are in this material world. If you perform more activities, karmic activities, you are bound. More and more, you are kind of, you are, how do you say, you are knotting up yourself into this material world. Get out of this. I am here. I am here to help you. So that's what his common clarion call in Bhagavad Gita is.
So any activity can be binding. So a good activity that we call good or what we call bad, they can both bind equally.
Yes.
So from our perspective, from a human being's perspective, how can we say absolutely this is absolute good and this is absolute evil?
Anything that is done in service of Krishna is absolute good. Anything that is against will of Krishna is absolute evil. See, the thing is, evil is something hurting myself, causing pain to me, and that's what it is. I'll tell an example. A man was in prison. He was a prisoner for some reason. He did a lot of good work in the prison. And he said, oh, you've been such a wonderful prisoner. You did so many things to the people. We have to reward you. Sure. You have to come back to the prison so that we can do whatever you did, that you did for others, we'll do for you. Are you crazy? Why would I come back to that prison? So good activity means you still have to come back to this material world to enjoy the good activities. And you are completely, it's an illusion. Don't even fall for that fake. I do something good. You know, I should get something good. Hi, Lauren. Haribol. I should get something good. But I have to come back to this material world and take the pain of birth, old age and disease. Why would I want to do that? Thank you very much. I don't want to get into the prison. No, you can keep your whatever good I did in the prison, you keep it. That's Krishna helping you to get rid of that good and bad karma. Karma good, karma bad, equal to bad. Because karma means you have to come back. I don't want that. So if you worship Krishna, you serve Krishna, you work for Krishna, and there is no karma. That's what Krishna is saying. It's such a profound thing because it's not easy. Material world, your instinct is to survive, your instinct is to gain, your instinct is to profit, and at costs that you don't understand and that reactions that are going to come that you don't. Krishna is saying, Savdhan, watch out, caution. Helpful. Okay, thank you. Mata and then Lauren.
Yeah, Hare Krishna, Prabhu.
Hare Krishna.
So, this question might be better later, so you can let me know, but in the whole chapter, the example it gives is of Bhishma Dev being devoured by Krishna because of his action in not protecting Draupadi. So, in this good and evil discussion, where is the line between the free will of the individual and the greater will of Krishna in, you know, especially in Bhishma's case, because he is a servant of Krishna, and in all, you know, he represents a pretty higher level as well. So I just wanted to see what that, if there was a discussion there or question there.
Bhishma actually is a devotee of Krishna. In fact, it is just, he is one of the 12 Mahajans. When he was killed by Krishna, he accepted it as being commonly killed by Krishna. But please understand
though the depiction here is that Bhishma is getting trapped into the mouth of Krishna, it's a little more symbolic because we know at the 9th chapter of the first canto, Lord Krishna personally comes and visits Bhishma. In fact, the story is so amazing that Bhishma was shot. Yes, we all know that story. He was shot, and please understand that it was not like, you know, he was shot, you know, with a single bullet to the heart. And then people said, all right, oh, Bhishma Pitamaha, you are just... In those days, the warriors, they would never be going back home. Because it was a Kshatriya honor that you die on the battlefield. Or coming back home wounded means you ran away from the battlefield. And that was such a great disgrace that no Kshatriya who was respectable would do that. So when the Kshatriyas would die, they would be dead on the battlefield. They wouldn't get to go anywhere. So it's not Bhishma Deva was shot an arrow and he was lying somewhere, and, oh, you're a respectable person. No, we'll shoot a bed of arrows, make it nice, put some pillows in. It was actually he was shot through the body. And the arrows went, they actually pierced and they went to the other end. And then all the whole of his body was arrows. And it is mentioned in Mahabharata that the arrows pierced him with such density, there was not even a gap for one more arrow to go through his body. Pretty much his whole of his body was pierced with arrows. And Arjuna came and he provided a bed because he was not shot above the head. There was no... So he was given a pillow and then he drank some water. Yudhishthir... Okay, here is the question. You have been unfairly kicked out of your house. Your wife has been insulted. And... pretty much you've been homeless for last 12 years, and 13th year if you're found homeless, then you would be going again 12 year homeless period. What would you, after killing that person, do? Post it on Facebook, Twitter, do cartwheels, get microphone, shout loudly to the world, and then just take that microphone and put it in the dead man's face. Yo, I got you. What would you do? And Yudhishthira could have done that. But, you know, after winning this Mahabharata war, Yudhishthira actually became depressed. You know that story? He actually became depressed. He said, just for my sake to be installed as a king, 16 million people were killed. I am the most sinful, wretched person. I am responsible for the deaths of all these people. So I'm not going to be the king. I'm going to go to forest and I'm going to perform sacrifice. Bhishma is a more angry person. He's like, why didn't you say before? For you, we fought all this battle, now you are saying, what is wrong with you? He was like really angry, upset. What's... And then, in any case, Krishna goes and consoles Yudhishthira. He says to Yudhishthira, oh Maharaj Yudhishthira, and he gives so much. But Yudhishthira is still not convinced, he's still depressed. He said, okay, you are not convinced, let's go and talk to Bhishma, because Bhishma is the person who is going to convince you. And they all go from Hastinapur to Kurukshetra to be with Bhishma, who was still not dead by that time, because he had the boon that he could give up his body whenever he chose to. So he was waiting for that auspicious time. So yes, in one sense, Bhishma was killed by Krishna, because Krishna is the death personified. Even though anybody can kill anybody, it's ultimately Krishna who's the sanction for the death. But Bhishma was actually getting darshan of Krishna towards the very end, and he gave up his body in a very, very glorious fashion. So, because he was a devotee, he had that special privilege. Others, not so much. Is that okay?
Yeah, no, I was just, in the later purports by Srila Prabhupada, he gives examples.
Yeah.
Well, you know, and he specifically picked Bhishma Dev, so I was wondering why he was picked
because
over the whole general idea.
Because he was also, he protested, but he was silent. Yeah, Draupadi's was a big turning point, like it or not, you know, when Duryodhana actually was killed by Bhima in an unfair means, towards the very end, actually, it said that both were fighting, and then Bhima tries to hit him on the legs, and then Duryodhan jumps up in the air to avoid that, but Krishna tells Bhima, aim your mace little higher, don't go like this, aim it little higher, and it went and hit his thigh, and the thigh bones were broken. And then Duryodhana was still not convinced about Krishna's supremacy. He tries to argue with Krishna, you are an unfair person, you did this, you did that. And then Krishna countered, saying that you, because of this, this happened, because of this, this happened. And then, but they go on and back and forth. And then Duryodhana is able to counter every Krishna's accusation of what harm did he do. But then when Krishna said, disrobing Draupadi, and Duryodhana says, yeah, that was too much. You shouldn't
Thank
have
you.
Done that.
Thank you.
Thank you. Lauren.
Hare Krishna. I just have a really quick question. You were explaining before that that our activities can be in two categories. They can either be something in service of the Lord or something that's against the Lord's will. Just a quick question is like when somebody has a mentality that they're doing something somehow in the service of the Lord that's not correct, I guess that's in the category of something against the Lord's will, whether the person may be in a Kanishta mentality is aware of it or not?
It depends. So, for example, Mother Yashoda was feeding Krishna from her body and the milk boiled. She put Krishna aside and then went to the stove to take out the milk that was overflowing. That is so against Krishna. You are feeding directly the Supreme Personality of God and you keep him aside and go. It's so against. And Lord Bhishma is against Krishna. In fact, he was fighting against Krishna. He was throwing war. Actually, it is said in Bhagavatam that when Bhishma released his arrows, they hit the body of Krishna and the blood was flowing. Oh my goodness gracious. That is so against Krishna. But Bhagavatam says that Krishna took it as flowers thrown at him. So, if you have a guidance of Guru, then they can truly interpret what is for Krishna and what is not for. Sometimes, if you are going to work and you have meeting with all sorts of materialistic people as part of your work and you think that is really not service for Krishna, but your guru will say that is what you should do now to keep continuing it. So in that sense, that becomes service for Krishna, though it may seem very materialistic. But on the other hand, one can be doing something in service of Krishna that could be so wrong. For example, you come to the temple, you are very casual about it. You think I'm coming to the temple and then I'm serving the deities, but you do it at very wrong time, no punctuality, and it's not clean. You just think, oh, I'm serving God, what's wrong? But your guru will come and chastise, say, no, it has to be very punctual, very clean, otherwise it's an offense. You're actually doing against Krishna, though apparently it seems you are in the temple trying to serve the Lord. So you can see that it's not black and white. There are multiple shades of gray that your spiritual master or other senior Vaishnavas can help clarify that. Thank you. Shall we proceed? We have verse number 55 to cover. And we have exactly 1 hour. Otherwise, the Sunday speaker will be very mad. Anyway, so we should follow the etiquette and not make the Sunday speaker mad. Though he's a useless fool. Text 28. Yata nadinam bahavam buvegam samudrameva bhimukha dravanti tata tavami naraloka vera Vishanti Vaktrana Vijvalanti.
As the many waves of the rivers flow into the ocean, so do all these great waters enter blazing into your mouth.
Thank you. Text 29. Yata pradiptam jvalanam patanga. Vishanti nashaya samruddha vegaha. Tataiva nashaya vishanti lokas. Tavapi vaktrani samruddha vegaha.
I see all people rushing full speed into your mouths as moths dash into to destruction in a blazing fire.
Thank you. Text 30. Lili hyase grasamana samantal. Lokan samagran vadanair jvalabdivihi. Tejo birapu ya jagat samagram. Bhashastavo gra pratipanti Vishnu.
O Vishnu, I see you devouring all people from all sides with your flaming mouths, covering all the universe with your effulgence. You are manifest with terrible scorching rays.
Thank you. Text 31. Akya himeko bhavanugrarupo. Namostute devavara prasida. Vijnatum icchami bhavantam adyam. Nahi prajanami tava pravrittim.
O Lord of Lords, so fierce of form, please tell me who you are. I offer my obeisances unto you. Please be gracious to me. You are the primal Lord. I want to know about you, for I do not know what your mission is.
Arjuna is completely bewildered. He thought Krishna was his friend, and now it's like he's very close, dear friend, whom you joke all these years. Suddenly comes with a big mask and like a frightening chaku or something like. You're like, who is this person? Text 32. Sri Bhagavan Uvacha. Kalosmi loka kshaya krit pravriddho. Lokan samahartumiha pravritta. Rite pitvam na bhavishyanti sarve. Yevastita prat. Yanikeshu Yoda.
The Supreme Personality of Godhead said, "Time I am, the great destroyer of the worlds, and I have come here to destroy all people, with the exception of you, the Pandavas. All the soldiers here on both sides will be slain."
Thank you. So Krishna at last tells, who is he? Is time I am. And I think this is the famous verse that was recited when the atom bomb was found, I guess. Yeah, the one of the scientists, Oppenheimer, who actually discovered the atom bomb and saw the power of this, then he quoted this verse. Time I am, the destroyer of the world. Text 33. One other point is, when Krishna shows his power and says, I am death, is it not really foolish that people in this world try to fight death? Yes, I will conquer over death. All I have to do is freeze my body, and when I can download my software back into my body, it will work fine. Actually, cryogenics, right, is a serious field of study where they freeze your bodies, charge you hundreds of thousands of dollars. After your death, they freeze your body, and somehow in future they can make you alive. If you die at 85, and they freeze your body for 25 years, assume you come back, would you be 120 or still 85? Neither of the options is acceptable, and let's not even discuss. Text 33. Tasmatvamuttishta yasho labhasva. Jitva shatrun bhunkshvarajyam samriddham. Mayaivaite nihita purvameva. Nimittamatram bhavasavyasachin.
Therefore, get up, prepare to fight and win glory, conquer your enemies and enjoy a flourishing kingdom. They are already put to death by my arrangement, and you, O Savyasachi, can be but an instrument in the fight.
So Krishna is pretty clear that Arjuna is not the cause of the death of his grandfathers. He's already killed. They're already killed by his desire. It's just he is the instrument. Text 34. Dronam cha bhishmam cha jayadratam cha. Karnam tatanyan api yodaviran. Maya hatam stvam jahima vyatishta. Yudhyas vajeta sirane sapatnan.
Drona, Bhishma, Jayadrata, Karna and the other great warriors have already been destroyed by me. Therefore, kill them and do not be disturbed. Simply fight and you will vanquish your enemies in battle.
So, let's read a purport, just first two, three lines. It's so nice. Every plan is made by the Supreme Personality of Godhead, but he is so kind and merciful to his devotees that he wants to give credit to his devotees who carry out his plan according to his desire. So, and let's continue. Life should therefore move in such a way that everyone acts in Krishna consciousness and understands the Supreme Personality of Godhead through the medium of spiritual master. The plans of the Supreme Personality of Godhead are understood by his mercy, and the plans of the devotees are as good as his plans. One should follow such plans and be victorious in the struggle for existence. So, Krishna does all the work, but he gives credit to his devotees. The other example is Jatayu and even Hanuman. So, Hanuman was fully empowered by Lord Ram, and yet he is known as a famous hero, and he is known as a famous servant of Lord Ram. Did Lord Ram actually need Hanuman? He could have done everything by himself, but he gives credit to his devotees. So that is his nature. And he highlights, yes, Prabhuji. No.
So in this verse, he's showing a lot of people dying, right? Drona, Bhishma, Jayadrath, Karna. An interesting thing is, Srila Prabhupada is saying this as every plan. He mentions this as if, and this actually shows that time is not something just a ticking clock, it's conscious. No. It has a plan. And I was thinking that why he shows Drona, Bhishma, Jayadratha, Karna getting killed, but not Abhimanyu, not the five sons,
who gets killed by Aswatthama. So time actually, I think, manifests, because it is conscious, it can make a choice what to manifest and what not to manifest, basically.
Yeah, and then, but in the earlier verses, Krishna says, except for you, find up five Pandavas, everyone else is. So he did make a mention of that. Other questions? Hare Krishna, please, you can sit down wherever you want to. Sanjaya Uvacha. Etat Shrutva Vachanam Keshavasya. Kritanjalir Vepamana Kiriti. Namaskritva Bhuya Evaha Krishnam. Sagad gadam bhita bhita pranamya.
Sanjay said to Dhritarashtra, O King, after hearing these words from the Supreme Personality of Godhead, the trembling Arjuna offered obeisances with folded hands again and again. He fearfully spoke to Lord Krishna in a faltering voice as follows.
Thank you. Text 36. Arjuna Uvacha. Stane Hrishikesha Tava Prakritya. Jagat Prahushyati Anurajyate Cha. Rakshami bhitani disho dravante. Sarve namasyanti cha siddha sangaha.
Arjuna said, O master of the senses, the world becomes joyful upon hearing your name, and thus everyone becomes attached to you. Although the perfected beings offer you their respectful homage, the demons are afraid and they flee here and there. All this is rightly done.
So Krishna is showing as death personified. Now please understand, death is feared by everyone, both the demons and the devotees. In fact, the Hiranyakashipu was so afraid of death, what did he do? He went to the mountains and performed severe austerities for doing what? Overcoming death. So death is something that everybody is afraid of. But devotees of Krishna, their fear of death is not so much as the non-devotees or the demons. Because demons perform such sinful activities, they're always afraid, you know, that their life can go at any time. And then they are responsible for the aftermath of their activities. But this is how the nature is. Krishna is fearful to the demons and he is pleasing to the devotees. And that's what it is mentioned here. Text 37.
Kasma chate na nameran mahatman. Gariyase Brahmanopyadi Kartre. Ananta Devesha Jagan Nivasa. Pramaksharam Sadasattat Paramya. O great one, greater even than Brahma, you are the original creator. Why then should they not offer their respectful obeisances unto you? O limitless one, God of God, refuge of the universe, you are the invincible source, the cause of all causes, transcendental to this material manifestation.
Thank you.
Text 38. Tvamadi deva purusha puranas. Tvamasya vishvasya param nidhanam. Vetasi vedyam cha param cha dhama. Tvaya tatam vishvam anantarupa.
You are the original personality of Godhead, the oldest, the ultimate sanctuary of this manifested cosmic world. You are the knower of everything and you are all that is knowable. You are the supreme refuge above the material modes, O limitless form. This whole cosmic manifestation is pervaded by you.
Thank you. Text 39. Vayur yamognir varuna shashanka. Prajapatistvam prapitamahascha. Namo namaste stu sahasra kritvaha. Punascha bhuyopi namo namaste.
You are air and you are supreme controller. You are fire, you are water and you are the moon. You are Brahma, the first living creature and you are the great grandfather. I therefore offer my respectful obeisances unto you 1,000 times and again and yet again.
Thank you, Urmi Mataji. Text 40. Nama purastad ataprashrit. Sorry. Nama purastad ataprishtataste. Namostu te sarvata eva sarva. Ananta viryamita vikramastvam. Sarvam samapnoshi tatosi sarva. If everybody is on Shraddha Mataji, you can start from the first. Okay, after that, Vishnu didn't get a chance, and later Mataji also. Yeah, you can do now. Vishnu, next you can read.
Obeisances to you from the front, from behind, and from all sides. O unbounded power, you are the master of limitless might. You are all-pervading, and thus you are everything.
Text 40 and 41. Sakheti matva prasabam yaduktam. He Krishna, he Yadava, he Sakheti. Ajatanata mahimana, sorry, ajanata mahimanam tavedam. Maya pramadat pranayena vapi. Yachavaha sartamasat kritosi. Vihara shayasana bhojaneshu. Ekota vapyachyuta tat samaksham. Tat kshama etvam aham aprameyam.
Thinking of you as my friend, I have rashly addressed you, O Krishna, O Yadava, O my friend, not knowing your glories. Please forgive whatever I may have done in madness or in love. I have dishonored you many times, jested as we relaxed, lay on the same bed, or sat or ate together, sometimes alone, and sometimes in front of many friends. O infallible one, please excuse me for all these offenses.
Yeah, text 43. Pitasi lokasya characharasya. Tvamasya pujyasya cha guru gariyan. Na tvat samostyabhyadiko kutonyo. So when it comes, the STY in the middle, and then A is it's sandhi, which means they are fused together. Natvat samostya bhi. So it goes like that. Samostya bhi. So otherwise it will go samosti abhi. So that there is no vowel in between. It goes natvat samast. Samostyadbhi abhya. It goes like that. Okay. Where are we? Here. Okay. Last one. Loka. So again, traye pya. From. So it goes pya. There is no gap here. Loka traye pya pratima prabhava. Loka traye pya pratima prabhava. So if you can see, so a and ya, so pya, it gets, because there is no a after y, it just gets pya. So, okay, who's next? You already did, right, Vishnu?
No, I
didn't. You did the previous one?
No,
he
didn't.
Who did?
No, he didn't. He has to.
Oh, he has to? Okay, sorry, Vishnu.
So, you are the father of the complete cosmic manifestation of the motive of the moving and the non-moving. You are the invisible chief, the supreme spiritual master. No one is equal to you, nor can anyone. He one with you. How then could there be anyone greater than you within the three worlds, O Lord of the unmeasurable power?
Text 44. So, there are nice purports. You know, that towards the end, there is quite few purports. Text 44. Tasmat pranamya pranidhaya kayam. Prasadaye tvam ahamesha medyam. Piteva putrasya sakheva sakhyu. Priya priyayar hasi deva shodhum.
You are the Supreme Lord, to be worshipped by every living being. Thus I fall down to offer you my respectful obeisances and ask your mercy. As a father tolerates the impudence of his son, a friend the impertinence and impertinence of a friend, or a husband the familiarity of his wife, please tolerate the wrongs I may have done you.
Thank you. Text 45. Any questions? Okay. We can take questions once we complete the chapter. Adrishta purvam shrichitosmi drishtva.
Adrishta purvam shrichitosmi drishtva.
Bhayena cha pravyatitam manome. Tadeva me darshaya deva rupam.
Prasida Devesha Jagannivasa.
After seeing this universal form which I have never seen before, I am gladdened, but at the same time my mind is disturbed with fear. Therefore, please bestow your grace upon me and reveal again your form as the personality of Godhead, O Lord of Lords, O abode of the universe.
Thank you. So it is mentioned in Nectar of Devotion that the friends of Krishna in Vrindavan, and Arjuna was also a friend of Krishna, but Arjuna's friendship towards Krishna was tinged with fear. But in Vrindavan, there was no question of fearing Krishna, because Krishna would ensure, take care, and be very conscious of the fact that he does not want to show himself as the Supreme Personality of Godhead. In fact, everything he does in Vrindavan, people think that Narayan saved him. This child had so much good fortune. You know, the demon as Putana came to kill, but he was saved by Lord Narayan because of his good fortune in his previous life, good karma. and Krishna would take care. In fact, we hear the story of how he killed the Kaliya serpent. And then at the end of that pastime, they were taking rest in that particular forest. And during the middle of night, there was a devouring forest fire coming them from all the sides. And then the calves and the cows were crying out to Krishna, please save us, this forest fire is really burning up and we are going to be killed and be burned to ashes in that forest fire. And then, you know what Krishna, normally an egoistic person will say, haha, look at me, what I'm going to do. You know what he said? Krishna said, my dear friends, please lay down on the ground and close your eyes. And then they all lay down on the ground and close their eyes. And Krishna, he takes on the whole of forest fire and he sucks it up. But then Acharya say, usually you need to show off because you need some Facebook likes and Twitter publicity going on. You need some promotions, some book deals. You need some fame and popularity. People get famous these days without doing anything also. But there Krishna did something. The Acharya say, because he asked them to close their eyes, he didn't want to give them even the slightest hint that he was the Supreme Lord. Because they would have the same reaction as Arjuna. Oh, you are so Supreme Lord, please forgive me. In my jest, I joked with you, insulted you, I laughed at you, and I did so many offenses to you, not knowing who you were, so please forgive me. And Krishna didn't want the Vrindavan Vasis to say that to him. So that's why he said, close your eyes, I have to do things. And then everything he did was in such a way that he would not give the hint that he was the Supreme Lord, the controller of everything, and the maintainer and the He is the power, he is all in all. He would never give that. Because that sweet rasa of Vrindavan, we should not be disturbed. But here, that's the difference. Yes, Sanket.
What about when he lifted the
Govardhan? When he lifted the Govardhan hill, actually, the cowherd men, they said, oh my God, this boy somehow is lifting Govardhan hill. Let's all put our sticks and hold it so that it wouldn't fall. We should all help this child somehow or other. They actually gave credit to Govardhan. Because we worshipped Govardhan, somehow it's floating on its own. And it's saving us. Krishna doesn't do anything. Krishna is not responsible. We are responsible for that's the mood of Vrindavan. Krishna is not our maintainer, we are his maintainers. Mother Yashoda thinks, if I don't feed him, he will die. The gopis of Vrindavan think that, you know, if we don't give him company, then, you know, he will be forlorn and lost, because that's his nature. That's the nature of Krishna. And therefore, the gopas, they climb Krishna's back.
they have this wrestling match, and then Krishna side is defeated, and the prize for being defeated is that the winners will go around on the body of the defeaters, and Krishna had to carry his own cowherd friends. Try doing that in the temple, trying to jump on Krishna's back in the temple murti. It's very grossly offensive. Because here is the mood is of awe and reverence, and the Vrindavan mood is very different. So till we get to that stage, and when we do the fourth semester, where we go into nectar of devotion, then we get into these intricacies of sadhana versus raganuga bhakti, vaidhi versus raganuga bhakti. Then you can realize the spontaneous love, and then Krishna accepts that love in that stage. But prematurely, if you do, then you have serious complications. Right? Yes, Shubhankar Prabhu. Shubhankar Prabhu.
So I have a question, may not be a little Bhagavad Gita, but I always feel that. So I will take chance to ask you. So does it mean that Vaishnavas who knows that Krishna's opulence and how great is Krishna, then is it possible, how is it possible they can enter into the other melos? I mean, because once you accept Krishna is almighty and all opulence, and you just like Arjuna, he knows, then it becomes always in the rush of dasya. So all the other melos, it becomes like, I don't know how to end. I mean, how they enter then. That does it mean that we will be always in the dasya rush forever?
Yes.
Okay.
So, it is mentioned in Nectar of Devotion that in the preliminary stage, each and every one of us has relationship with Krishna and eternal relationship with Krishna. But we do not know at this point of time. As we advance in devotional service, then when we reach the spontaneous, you are naturally attracted to Krishna, then a mood of service to Krishna emerges. And that mood of service, then you are called a Raganuga Bhakta. But that's not enough. You have to practice that Raganuga Bhakti under the guidance of a Ragatmika Bhakta, who is a resident of Vrindavan, and they can train you in that further aspect on how to serve Krishna. Just to go and write some code in a company, you have to do 5 and 6 hours of interview and be really breaking head just to do what? Write some code. And you go to Krishna and just like that, yeah, Krishna, I love Krishna, Krishna loves me. Thank you very much. There is a whole science that is mentioned by Rupa Goswami that it takes a while before one enters into those kind of mellows. So in our stage, in the sadhana stage that we most of us are, then we actually don't override the opulence of Krishna. As I said before, you don't come to the temple and jump onto the back of Krishna's murti here thinking that I am his friend. It's a grave offense. When we reach that stage, it naturally comes. You don't have to force yourself to on that levels. Because through when you perform your devotion, that naturally emerges. Just like a caterpillar, it becomes a butterfly. It's a natural process. You don't force that process. It takes its own thing. In fact, it is said that if you break the cocoon, the butterfly is crippled forever, because that pushing through that cocoon actually gives the power for and the strength to flap its wings. So it's a natural process. It's not an artificial process. People who kind of say that you can jump over according to what you think, that is a very grave misconception. Is that okay? Okay. Should we go? Text 45? 10 more verses.
अदृष्टपूर्वं शिक्षितोऽस्मि दृष्ट्वा भयेन च प्रव्यतितं मनो मे तदेव मे दर्शय देवरूपम् प्रसीद देवेश जगन्निवास
After seeing this universal form which I have never seen before,
I'm gladdened, but at the same time my mind is disturbed with fear. Therefore, please bestow your grace upon me and reveal again your form as the personality of Godhead, O Lord of Lords, O Abode of the Universe.
Thank you. Text 46.
Kiritinam gadinam chakrahastam. Icchami tvam dashtumarham tataiva. Tenaiva rupena chaturbhujena. Sahasrabaho bhava vishvamurte.
O universal form, O thousand-armed Lord, I wish to see you in your four-armed form with helmeted head and with club, wheel, conch and lotus flower in your hands. I long to see you in that form.
Thank you. Text 47. Sri Bhagavan Uvacha. Maya prasannena tava arjunedam. Rupam param darshitam atma yoga. Tejo mayam vishvam anantam adyam. Yanme tvadanyena na drishta purvam.
The Supreme Personality of Godhead said, My dear Arjun, happily have I shown you by my internal potency this supreme universal form within the material world. No one before you has ever seen this primal form, unlimited and full of glaring effulgence.
Thank you. Text 48.
Na veda yajna dhyanair na dhanair. Na chakriyabir na tapo bhirugraihi. Evam rupa shakya aham niloke. Drashtum tvadanyena kuru pravira.
O best of the Kuru warriors, no one before you has ever seen this universal form of mine. For neither by studying the Vedas, nor by performing sacrifices, nor by charity, nor by pious activities, nor by severe penances, can I be seen in this form in the material world.
Thank you. So it's a nice purport. Srila Prabhupada writes that unless one becomes a devotee of Krishna, it's impossible to see the universal form. And it's a fact, because this material world is pervaded by Krishna. You and I can't see it unless Krishna reveals himself. But this whole world is actually being controlled and owned by Krishna. And whenever he chooses, he'll just, this is done. So, text 49.
Mate vyatama cha vimudha bhavo. Drishtva rupam gorami drinmamedam. Yapeta bhi prita mana punastvam. Tadeva me rupam idam prapasya.
You have been
perturbed and bewildered by seeing this horrible feature of mine. Now let it be finished, my devotee. Be free again from all disturbances. With a peaceful mind, you can now see the form you desire.
Thank you. Text 50. Sanjaya Vacha. Ityarjunam Vasudevas Tatoktva. Svakam Rupam Darshayama Sabhuyaha. Ashvasayam Asachabhitamenam. Bhutva puna saumya vapur mahatma.
So you can look it up in the. Can you do the translation first?
Sanjaya said to Dhritarashtra, the Supreme Personality of Godhead Krishna, having spoken thus to Arjuna, displayed his real four-armed form and at last showed his two-armed form, thus encouraging the fearful Arjuna.
So Saumya Vapu, it's okay. Saumya Vapu is the beautiful form. Saumya means beautiful, Vapu's form. Saumya Vapu. So Srila Prabhupada writes in the purport that when Krishna was born in the dungeons of Kamsa, he showed his four-armed form first to Devaki, and then Devaki was like, okay, you are showing the form of Vishnu. Wow, Kamsa is going to come and kill you. So please show your two-armed form, become a small baby. And that's how Krishna shows his two-armed form. It's mentioned in the purport. Text 51. Okay, so enough of those huge lines. Okay, done. Text 51. Arjuna Vacha. Drishtvedam Manusham Rupam. Tava Saumyam Janardana. Idanim Asmi Samvrittaha. Sacheta prakritim gataha.
When Arjuna thus saw Krishna in his original form, he said, O Janardana, seeing this human-like form, so very beautiful, I am now composed in mind and I am restored to my original nature.
So here you can see that Arjuna is back, seeing the form of Krishna as the two-handed form. There are two or three things that we can tell from this. That two-handed form of Krishna is the actual original form of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. So it, because people think you and I have two arms, how can Krishna have two arms? He should have at least two more arms, right? He's saying, God, he should have at least something better than me. Otherwise, how is he Krishna? Or the Mayavad philosophers twist it. God is impersonal. But when he comes to this material world, he has two arms and he has a form like us. And he becomes like us. That's why he has two arms. See the perverted logic it goes. So, but here, the other thing, with all due respects, I don't know, I'll pick one person. Don't mind Shraddha. Pick you. So Sid has two arms, right? And then it's not like I see Sid, then I get peaceful and composed. Not that he's not a peaceful, composed person. I like him very much. But the fact of the matter is, if Krishna was an ordinary human being who was restored to his two arms, Arjuna wouldn't say that now I am composed. Now I am able to see this beautiful form. Nor would Krishna say later, saying that this form is so beautiful, even the demigods can't see it. I can see Sid right now. I don't need to be a demigod to see. But Krishna says, so the original two-handed form is something very original form of Krishna, and it's mentioned in Bhagavad Gita. People say we read Bhagavad Gita, everything is about Krishna being impersonal. But Krishna is personal, and this 11th chapter especially drives home that point. Not that now I'm seeing Sid, I'm also composed in mind a little bit. I don't know, I have returned to my original nature or not. No, probably not, but. Text 51. Text 52 rather, sorry. Sri Bhagavan Uvacha. Sudurdarsham idam rupam. Drishtvan asiyan mama. Sorry. Drishtavan asiyan mama. Deva apyasya rupasya. Nityam darshanakankshinaha.
The Supreme Personality of Godhead said, "My dear Arjuna, this form of mine you are now seeing is very difficult to behold. Even the demigods are ever seeking the opportunity to see this form, which is so dear."
Thank you. So, Srila Prabhupada writes in the purport, he says, in the previous things we read that universal form, neither by performing yajna nor by tapasya nor by dana can they see it. And here Krishna says, sudurdarsham, means it's even more difficult to see this beautiful form of mine, which is that the universal form is little lower in terms of Krishna about seeing rather than seeing the 200 form. So people think that God means he must be infinite, he must be always showing that he is God. Otherwise, I won't accept it. So universal form is better. Because nobody can have universal form. God has a universal form. So God should be the universal form. But Krishna says, no, this form of mine is even more difficult to behold. Even the demigods are eager to see that form of mine. And it's a beautiful purport. Please take time to read. Text 53. Naham vedair na tapasa, na dhanena na chejaya, shakya evam vido drashtum, drishtavanasi mam yatha.
The form you are seeing with your transcendental eyes cannot be understood simply by studying the Vedas, nor by undergoing serious penances, nor by charity, nor by worship. It is not by these means that one can see me as I am.
Thank you. Text 54. Bhaktya tvananyaya shakya aham evam vidorjuna jnatum drashtum cha tatvena praveshtim cha parantapa.
My dear Arjuna, only by undivided devotional service can I be understood as I am, standing before you and can thus be seen directly. Only in this way can you enter into the mysteries of my understanding.
Thank you. So here Krishna is pretty clear, because in the earlier chapters, in the first semester, we talked of different yogas, Sankhya. He talked about jnana, karma, and you know, dhyana, thank you, dhyana yoga. But Krishna says, only through devotional service can you know me as I am. And that is the only way that Krishna can be known. And one of the reasons why, you know, bhakti is so important, and why ISKCON stresses bhakti, other than, you know, daily you don't come and do the yoga postures for 1 hour, or breathing exercise for another hour, and then, you know, doing Surya Namaskar for another couple of hours. But you guys are just chanting Hare Krishna. What's your purpose? What's your point? You know, God can be achieved in so many ways. You're just wasting your time. The same God said also, right, that you should go to forest and sit on the mat and do breathing exercise. Why are you not doing that? because we are here directly to understand Krishna. And Krishna says only through bhakti can you understand me. So we are not wasting time with other processes. It's not that, then people say, then why is God wasting his time telling all these things? Why, he can just say, sarvadharman parityaja, or two or three verses, you are done with Bhagavad Gita. But the fact of the matter is that not everybody can immediately take up to the process of bhakti or think that it is important. Unless, try to understand, you know, there are cars that cost you $20,000, brand new cars. And there are cars that cost you $350,000 or even $500,000. What is the difference between that? Is that the material there is made of gold or jewels? What is the difference? A little bit more faster. The point is it worth paying that much kind of money? But people are mad after those high-end cars. They put posters of those cars in their rooms, especially the boys. They put the, they get the small cars holding on to them. Oh, this is my dream car. My life would be perfect if I'd be riding in this car. And when you have a cheap car or a reliably good car, this is nothing. The idea is that if you do something really, you know, stand on your legs for like 2 days or not eat, there has to be some really expensive fancy stuff, then the results are good. Otherwise, results are pretty not so good. But the, Krishna says, bhakti is something that you is easy and you can achieve me. And people think, this you guys are like, you know, it's all emotions and sentiments. There is nothing hardcore science behind it. But this is the hardcore science behind it. Yes, Goran.
Hare Krishna. I had just had a question after after your explanation was finished.
Yes, Prabhuji.
So the prior verse, you know, Krishna says that this two-armed form, this is a form that even the demigods, they're anxious to see, but is possibly a little bit beyond their view.
Right.
Then the next verse, Krishna tells Arjuna that only by undivided devotional service can I be understood as I am standing before you and can thus be seen directly. Does this imply anything about the type of devotional service of the demigods to the Lord?
It very much does. So the demigods, they are called sakam devotees, means they worship God with a material motive, out of fear. God comes, so they collect, so when people do sacrifices, Krishna says in the third chapter, in the beginning, I created demigods. I created human beings. Human beings perform sacrifices to the demigods. The demigods accept their sacrifices and they give all the benefits to the human beings like rain, sun, so on and so forth. So that there will be economic prosperity. Thank you, Mataji. There will be economic prosperity all around. So the demigods, they take the portion of their sacrifice and give it portion to Lord Vishnu. In fact, they first offer it to Lord Vishnu and then only they take. So the reason they do that is because they have to maintain their status. I need my planet, my apsaras, my elephant, my planes, my thunderbolt. If I don't give everything to Vishnu, he'll take it away. Or he won't, more important, if the demons attack me, then he won't come to save us. Anytime they have problem with demons, they go to Lord Vishnu, please save us. You know, then Lord Vishnu kind of helps them. So the demons are there. And they can come and run over my kingdom anytime. I'll be a homeless person. So I need to get. So their whole thinking is like that. And their motive is to actually keep their own things in place. And that's why. And usually they do that. Lord Vishnu is appearing to each of these places in the four-handed forms. Most of the places you can see in Bhagavatam and other places, four arms, sometimes eight arms. In one place in Bhagavatam, it's mentioned he showed eight arms. But otherwise, he comes as four-handed form. And rarely the two-handed form can hold charm to the demigods. That's why they are confused. Indra comes, who is this boy? He dissuaded these Vrindavan people from From my sacrifice? How dare he? Let him show me my power. I'm going to destroy Vrindavan with my reins. Hare Baba, he is Lord Vishnu, he is the source of Lord Vishnu. But he can't see that. At that point they couldn't fathom it. So even the demigods, they can't know Krishna in the two-handed form that he is, and that's why they get tripped over. Brahma also thought that, you know, this is a magician. I am the supreme magician in this whole universe. This boy has come, done some tricks. I'll show you. And then he steals all the calves and cowherds, and then he's completely like, wow, what did I do? Then he says, you are the original Lord Vishnu. Are you not the source of Lord Vishnu? He says in his prayers. So even the demigods, they rarely get a chance to see the Lord in his 200 forms. And that's why Bhagavatam praises that demigods who yearn to see the Lord in his 200 forms, who are these Vrindavan Vasis? They are playing with him as if like he's their own. He's one of their equals. He's playing with them. That same absolute truth is playing with all these boys. And that too, not very sophisticated boys and girls, as if he's their own. So, yeah. Is that helpful? Okay. I wanted to read the purport, okay, but last verse, we can stop. I wanted to read the purport, but please read it at home. It's a beautiful purport. Text 55. Mat karma krin mat paramo. Mat bhakta sangha varjita. Nirvairair sarvabhuteshu. Yaha samameti pandava. Okay. Shraddha, try reading the Sanskrit.
My dear Arjuna.
No, just the Sanskrit, we'll follow you.
Sanskrit.
Try, give it a shot. Sorry, I didn't mean to put you on a spot.
Mat karma krin mat paramo.
Mat karma krin mat paramo.
Mad bhakta sangha varjita.
Mad bhakta sangha varjita.
Nirvaira sarva bhuteshu.
Nirvaira sarva bhuteshu.
Yase mam iti pandava.
Yahasa mam iti pandava. The reason I asked is this verse is a memorization verse, one of the memorization verses, and who knows. So the reason why this verse has been chosen is because if you read the purport, we'll read the purport just a little bit and then we can do, okay. No, just the beginning of the purport, the first paragraph. Anyone who wants to approach the supreme of all personalities of Godhead on the Krishna Loka in the spiritual sky and be intimately connected with the supreme personality of Godhead, Krishna, must take this formula as stated by the Supreme Himself. Therefore, this verse is considered to be the essence of Bhagavad Gita. So, that's why I pick this verse. So we'll stop here. We'll meet in 2 weeks' time. Any questions, any comments? It's okay. We can run over also. On Sunday feast speaker, I don't care. Yes, Lauren had a question and then.
Were we going to read the translation?
Yes, please.
My dear Arjuna, he who engages in my pure devotional service, free from contaminations of fruitive activities and mental speculations, he who works for me, who makes me the supreme goal of life, and who is friendly to every living being, he certainly comes to me.
Thank you. Any question? You had a question, Prabhuji?
So Krishna says in one of the previous verse that this two-arm form you are seeing, Arjuna, this with your transcendental vision, the demigods cannot see this form.
Right.
I mean, although they try to. So what does he mean basically? Because Indra does see him, and then, you know, other demigods also see him. So what does he mean?
So that's what it's mentioned in Brihad Bhagavatamrita, that when Narada goes to each of the places, in the first part of Brihad Bhagavatamrita, the goal is, Avantika, are you going to have a class now or 5 minutes now? Pardon?
Now?
Okay. Because I wanted someone to lead Kirtan for 5-10 minutes, but it's fine. No problems. So in Brihad Bhagavatamrita part 1, the goal of Narada is to see who received the highest mercy of Krishna. Who is the devotee of, amongst all these devotees, who achieved the highest mercy of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. So the first place he goes is, he goes to a Brahman in Prayag, and he sees that that Brahman's devotional performances touches Narada so much that he says, you are the beneficiary of the Supreme. You are the most wonderful devotee of the Lord, and he has given you the maximum mercy. And the Brahmana, what are you talking? I'm just useless. There is a king in South India. He is more. And then he goes to the king. Really? I'm the Supreme Lord's most merciful devotee. Nah. And there is someone else. And then it goes on. And it goes, then they said, go to Indra. Then go to, Indra says, nah, I am not a Brahma. Brahma says, no, Shiva. So in that place, Narada visits each of the planets of Indra, and he visits the planets of Brahma. In each of these places, actually the Lord comes to accept the offerings of the sacrifices, but he comes in his four-handed form. So they barely get to see the two-handed form of Krishna as he is.
To fight Indra to get the Parijat flowers, right? I mean, there was a fight. So that happened in his four-hand form, basically, when...
No, that happened in his two-hand form. Maybe four-hand form, they were scared. They would have given Parijata.
Yeah.
He was showing his two-handed form. He's like, we can, let's fight.
Okay.
That's the problem. So they are used to seeing the Lord in the four-handed form.
Mm.
That this two-handed form is something which is not... Even the Lord doesn't show them these 200 okay. forms.
So it was not, probably, they were not seeing the complete transcendental form, I guess.
You can say that in one sense, yeah.
Okay.
Okay, we'll take a break here. And we'll just take a 2-minute break. You can stretch your legs and just jog around the block if you want to, or whatever. And then we'll come back for the Sunday feast lecture, if that's okay. Okay, thank you so very much. Thank you for patiently coming and hearing. I'm grateful that you gave me a chance to serve you today. Vancha kalpataru vyas chakra.